Welcome.
I invite you to stand as you're able and join me in the call to worship. Come, let us draw near to the one who breaks down barriers and extends grace to all. We come with hearts open to the healing touch of Christ. Jesus welcomes those who seek him, regardless of background or circumstance. We come trusting in God's power to make all things new. Let us worship the one who opens our ears to hear and our mouths to speak praise. We come ready to proclaim God's goodness.
Meanwhile, you're all standing there with expectation that Michelle's finally going to learn how to work her microphone. It is a good and glorious thing to be gathered together in the worship of God this morning. Wherever we come from, wherever we're heading, wherever we've been, whatever trajectory has brought us here, God has called us to this place and this time. Whether this place is here in the sanctuary, whether you are watching on participating online in some form through our live stream or our YouTube later in this week, whether you're listening by phone or podcast, it is good and glorious to be together in the worship of God. I invite you at this point, to offer signs of Christ's peace to each other and to the world. If you're in this room, I invite you to try a variation of sign language that is this right palm on top of left. Turn those over and bring your hands down to your sides. And then in front of you, knuckles together and thumbs on top. And I invite you to push that out from your body. And that is peace I give to you. And if you can exchange that sign or another sign of peace and joy within the room, I invite you to do that. If you are at home this morning, I invite you to offer that peace to everyone around you. And if you are all alone, go to your front door and put that peace out into the neighborhood.
Seated, and join me in praying the prayer of confession found printed in the bulletin. Let us pray. Holy One, we confess that we often fail to see the breadth of your love and the reach of your grace. We limit your power by our doubts and restrict your mercy by our prejudices. Forgive us for the times we have turned away from those who are different from us. Open our hearts, Lord, to the fullness of your love, and teach us to embrace all our neighbors. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hear the good news. The mercy of God knows no bounds and is offered freely to all. In Christ, we are healed, forgiven, and restored. Amen.
Our scripture reading is from Mark, verses 24 through 37. Jesus left that place and went into the region of Tyre. He didn't want anyone to know that he had entered a house, but he couldn't hide. In fact, a woman whose young daughter was possessed by an unclean spirit heard about him right away. She came and fell at his feet. The woman was Greek, Syrophoenician by birth. She begged Jesus to throw the demon out of her daughter. He responded, "The children have to be fed first. It isn't right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs." But she answered, "Lord, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." "Good answer," he said. "Go on home. The demon has already left your daughter. When she returned to her house, she found the child lying on the bed and the demon gone. After leaving the region of Tyre, Jesus went through Sidon toward the Galilee Sea, through the region of 10 cities. Some people brought to him a man who was deaf and could hardly speak, and they begged him to place his hand on the man for healing. Jesus took him away from the crowd by himself and put his fingers in the man's ears. Then he spit and touched the man's tongue. Looking into heaven, Jesus sighed deeply and said, "Ephphatha," which means "open up." At once his ears opened, his twisted tongue was released, and he began to speak clearly. Jesus gave the people strict orders not to tell anyone. But the more he tried to silence them, the more eagerly they shared the news. People were overcome with wonder, saying, "He does everything well. He even makes the deaf to hear and give speech to those who can't speak." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. loves the little children, all the children of the world, and he loves each and every one of you too. At this moment, I ask the children to come down for children's time. And Richmond and Bible Beat will be upstairs. Come pick your children upstairs and get a bag of popcorn. Come on down, my friends. I have plenty. Thanks, Griff. My heart is so full to see all of you here. You just made my day. Good morning, my friends. Let's say good morning to those that are watching with us and participating in worship with us. Good morning. I have a question for you. You just finished, most of you, your first week of school. How many of you went to maybe a different school or a different classroom? Maybe it was a little scary. How many of you went to somewhere different? And was the first day harder than the last day? Yes, it got better as the week went on. I ask that because in the scripture we just heard read, Jesus was in a strange land. Actually, he was in a place that he was not supposed to be. I think maybe he just needed a vacation, a break. But even there, he had to do God's work. He healed people. He healed a little girl, and he healed a man who was deaf. He wasn't supposed to do that. In fact, he told everyone, shh, don't tell them I did this. I'm not supposed to be doing this right now. But you know what? He is so full of God's love, he couldn't help himself. So what is a lesson we're supposed to learn from that, my friends? What do you think it is, Sean?
Spread love everywhere you go.
Sean, you can have my chair. That is exactly what I was going to say, Sean.
Wait, you mean I can sit in your chair?
You can sit in my chair. You did such a great job. Yes, we are supposed to be like Jesus and spread God's love. How can we do that? How can we do that maybe at school? It's easy here to do it at church because we all are the same. We all believe the same. It's kind of easy here. But when we go to school, think about it. Does anybody have a way that we can spread God's love at school? Oh, yes, Everett, what do you think it is?
Giving hugs to people if they're sad and they ask for one, or you ask if they need help, or if they say yes, you can give them hugs.
Everett, you could have my chair too. That is wonderful. You know what? I like how you said it's not just give a hug. You ask somebody if they would like a hug, if they're feeling sad. That's wonderful. Yes, Elliot. Oh, you're going to show me? Oh, shaking someone's hand. I think it's all of it. It's connecting with somebody. If you see someone like maybe at the lunch table sitting alone, kind of looking like they don't are sad or something, you go sit next to them. You introduce yourself. Hi, I'm Paula. Can I have lunch with you today?
You made my love.
Oh. So I'm going to challenge you all this coming week to go and spread God's love at school. Find a way to make someone's day just a little brighter because you're in it. Let's close with a prayer, and then we're going to say the Lord's Prayer all together. Dear God, thank you for these beautiful children as they venture off to a new school year. Be with them. Remind them that they are there to spread your love. Help them to find the right moment to do that. And in spreading God's love, Jesus taught us a prayer. Let us say it all together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Please be seated. All right, so it's confession time. Yours, not mine, by the way. Today's scripture begs the question, so I'm going to ask it. Here it is. How many times have you ever broken a rule? Oh. The choir was louder than the congregation. Just saying. Good rules, bad rules, any rules. How many rule breakers in the room? Wow. I got my work to do. I'm not going to tell you which rules I may have broken, though I will say that the first same-gender wedding I officiated was long before this general conference this last year. So I will freely admit with you that I have broken a few rules here and there. Some I knew I was breaking. Some I didn't. Maybe some of them should not have been broken, but some definitely should have. Feels sort of awkward to admit that, doesn't it? Especially in church. The place most people seem to think is all about rules. Rules for behavior, rules about people, rules about practice, rules about belief, rules and commandments, and thou shalt not. Do you know how many people stay away from church because they have some idea, right or wrong, about all these rules that this is what church is really all about, that this is what the nature of faith is, along with, of course, all the punishments for breaking all the rules. I can't blame people for thinking that. That's what seems to come out every time a story emerges about church in the news, every time some multimillionaire preacher with two jets opens his mouth. So at this point in the conversation about rules, I refer you to Jesus. Is he a rule breaker? Is he a rule keeper? Which? So let's see about that. This gospel reading has us following Jesus away from his people and place. He has ventured out of bounds. He has left Jewish territory and gone off into the land of the Gentiles, meaning the land of the not Jews. People good Jews should not associate with in the first century. Tyre and Sidon and the Decapolis, the 10 towns, all Gentile territory, all full of people who have no need for Jewish law or customs, no understanding of the Hebrew God, no connection to the faith in which Jesus is so enmeshed. And honestly, he is there because he's just trying to get a break. You know that feeling. You can hear it in the secrecy that Mark talks about. You can hear it in that first verse in the reading. Jesus goes into a house and hopes no one finds him there. He's trying to hide, maybe, away from the demands, the healing constantly, the scrutiny, maybe away from the rules that the Pharisees keep hammering on with him. But the rules he follows follow him. And he is where he does not belong. Somehow word about who he is and what he has done gets out, and a woman approaches him to heal her daughter. By the rules he should not. By the laws that govern him, he should not. She is a Gentile and she is a woman. By the laws that govern him, he should do nothing. And he tells her so. Pretty rudely, actually. He's abrupt, he's judgmental, and he's not very Jesus-y. He has decided that she is not worthy. What he does, who he is not for her. And he scolds her for even coming to him, for breaking all the rules to approach him in the first place. He calls her a dog. Not, as some scholars would like to soften it and argue, that not like the cute family pet, not like your little chihuahua who gets fat and happy on a cushion, not even like puppy. It is, you know Jim Croce and the junkyard dog, right? Bad, bad Leroy Brown, meaner than a junkyard dog. That's the kind of dog he's talking about. A cur, a dog of the streets. Ooh. And then she becomes my hero. She stands up and she speaks up and she reminds him that sometimes rules should be broken. Justice should be demanded. Healing must happen. And she doesn't care a fig about his rules. And he listens. He hears her and he is changed. By the way, there's a whole lot of Christians who are uninterested in accepting the fact that Jesus changed. That whole exchange reminds me of the story of Abraham talking God down from a particularly fierce city-annihilating threat in Genesis. That's your homework, Genesis 18, 16 to 33. This woman who will do anything for her child, who challenges his rules, changes his mind. He goes from this encounter even deeper into Gentile territory to do more healing, more restoring, more bringing people back into wholeness. This man he heals is doubly or triply unclean according to the religious rules. Not only is he in the land of the Gentiles, and we don't know if he's a Gentile or a Jew, it's not specific, but it could be a strike against him. He is deaf and he cannot speak. Disability is generally attributed to sin, his or his parents. And Jesus should not be near him, much less touch him. Yet Jesus, who has had his mind and heart moved, takes this man aside, away from the crowd, and touches him and heals him, and he is restored. Woo! There went my glass of water. Sometimes rules should be broken, yes? But which ones? And who gets to decide? Rules that exclude, rules that narrow, rules that harm more than they heal. These are the rules that should not stand. These are the rules that the saints we praise spoke up to protest, sometimes giving their lives. Here's where a lot of folks inside and outside the church misunderstand the nature of our faith and what it means to live the Jesus way. The Christian call is not to enforce rules for the sake of preserving them and the power that created them. The Christian call, when coming up against the rules, is to hold them up to the light, to name their nature, healing or harming, and then to act accordingly. Now, for some, that requires completely rewiring the way we do things. Because after all, and we should know this, but too often we act as if we don't, our job is not to play God, saying who is in and who is out, who gets what and when. Our job is to imitate Jesus, to see with the eyes of God, to love with the heart of God, to heal, to restore, to revitalize, to create wholeness and to connect people with God. It is not to divide, not to separate, not to establish boundaries and territories that we then are willing to defend to the death. It is not to create impossible standards nobody can meet, and then to judge them when they can't. Our job is not to make sure we come out ahead with all our wants met at the expense of others' needs. Jesus does that exactly once in the scriptures, right here. And we see that he moves quickly from there when he's brought up against the harm done by his kind of thinking. Now, I don't know if you've noticed, but we currently have two political parties at odds and fighting about the rules for a nation of very diverse people. We are in camps, arrayed against each other at war. We've got all sorts of thoughts about who is right and who is wrong and whose rules should stand, whose rules shall be the law of the land. But take it back to the way of Jesus. What are the rules that harm and what are the rules that heal? In the wake of yet another school shooting this week, we have to question whether the rule that allows just about anyone to own a firearm is a healing rule or a harming one. By the way, as of August 31st, there have been over 2,000 casualties in 432 mass shootings in the U.S. That does not count September and this last week. In the face of continuing war in Gaza, where 42,000 people, overwhelmingly Palestinian, have died to date, and in Ukraine with 500,000 deaths to date, we have to question the rules we hold on to when other countries are at war. Are we war makers or peacemakers, healers or harmers? What is the Christian way of assessing geopolitics for those of us who call ourselves Christian? In a nation with growing poverty and indiscriminate hunger, we have to question the cultural and governmental rules that we've put in place that continue to create poverty and hunger, homelessness, hopelessness. For many, that's way too hard because rules are easier. Living with the rules and complaining about them is a lot easier. Rules create structures and hierarchies and allow some to have power at the expense of others. Rules help us remove the human face and allow us to act based on greed or control or money or the striving for power. Rules allow us to say no instead of yes, to feel the luxury of superiority. And they completely close us off into our own little silos, where we don't have to care a fig about their impact. Is that really the way we want to live? Now, I am not talking about a society without rules. Please do not hear that. I am not advocating anarchy. Nor am I anywhere near being a libertarian. What I do think is that Jesus calls us to another way, a way of hope and healing, a way of light and life, a way of greater good. And when we claim his name, when we call ourselves Christians, he calls us to be that life, to do that work. And sometimes that means completely reevaluating and rearranging the way we do absolutely everything. I think the question out of this text for us is, can we change our thinking enough to do that? Can we voluntarily give up the control and safety that our established rule structures give us, whether we are opposing them or for them? Can we look with Jesus' eyes at our space and our place and our time and the way we live as his people in this community and the wider world and act accordingly? It's challenging because it calls us out of ourselves and our habits. It calls us to unknown territories and to do things we've never done before. It's exciting and terrifying, and you know what? That is quite often what God's work looks like, feels like. But it's exciting because in this, God is working hard on us, helping us to see and to hear where we have made rules that need to be broken, the ones that harm people intentionally or unintentionally. God is helping us to see what we need to do to be the people of hope and promise we were created to be. God is helping us to discern which rules can be softly shaped and which ones need a battering ram. For me, that's what church is for. I believe that the community of faith exists precisely so that we can help each other with that hard work. So that we can hold each other up when we falter at it, and we will. So that we can present a joyful, unified force of resistance to evil and wrong and harm. We do that work of healing and restoring the world together, and it's our connection that makes us strong enough to do it. One of the gifts of the United Methodist denomination, and one of the things I love most about it, is what we call our connection. We are all in this work together, all across the globe. Everywhere there's a United Methodist Church, we are connected to each other. Through our structures, yes, but also through our determination to make the world a better place. That's what we're doing today at Asbury First, this Connection Sunday. We're connecting or reconnecting with our call to be Christian in the world. Well, actually, we're hopefully doing that every Sunday, but this Sunday in particular, we have a chance to step up and to say, I want to be part of this. I want to be part of a united front of healing and hope. Following worship, and you may have seen some of this already, you're invited to step over into the gathering center, not just for cookies and treats, but to see what possibilities exist for joining together to make an impact in the world through this congregation. All our ministry areas are represented. Every table has information and people to tell you about the work they do in that area. And every table has a place to sign up and join and say, I want to be a part of this. There is a place for each one in the work Christ's church is called to do. There are tasks of every size, but all of them important. There is a place for each one of us in Christ's work. And some of it's even about rule breaking. Thanks be to God. That's good news. Amen.
Let us pray. Gracious, loving God, we open our hearts to you. Hear our prayers. We lift to you all who are suffering in this moment, in body, mind, heart, and soul. Open them to accept healing and forgiveness, and help them to forgive themselves if they caused their own pain. Release us each and all from whatever holds us back from full awareness of you in our lives. Breathe into us the breath of your own spirit to give us renewed energy and strength. We pray for the places of trauma and violence in this world, for those who are victims, and for those who are perpetrators. Please work within the situations to bring each one to the place of forgiving and accepting forgiveness. We thank you for the wonders and beauty of the world, for reunions with lifelong friends, for easy conversations and memories shared. We thank you for all that makes us happy, for every smile and giggle. We thank you for the military personnel and ask that you keep them safe. Be especially with their families. Be in the eyes and ears and hearts and minds of all medical personnel and all law officers. May they know how grateful we are for the work they do and for the ways they serve. In this moment, loving God, remind us that we are yours, however we know you and whatever we are feeling right now. Spread your healing holy balm around us so that our words are your words, our hearts are your heart, and our breath is your very breath. Amen.
There are so many ways to connect and be a part of ministry. One of them you'll see later as Mike invites the ushers up to collect our gift for ministry. Our gifts of resources, financial and time and spiritual, are all important. You've also got a red pad in your pew. I invite you to find that and connect with each other by signing that and greeting the people in your pew, particularly if you have not met yet. There are other ways to connect. I mentioned the Giving Center and the Mission Fair out there, Ministry Fair out there this morning, but Mike's got a whole bunch of other things to tell you about.
Oh my golly gee willikers, there are so many ways to connect at Asbury First. So we're just gonna take the next, I don't know, hour or so, and we're just gonna go through them one by one. Go ahead and raise your, no. But in earnest, whether you're here in person or whether you're participating online or in some other capacity, we encourage you to check out our website and find new ways to get involved. For our children, there's Sunday schools, there's Wednesday evening programmings and music. For youth, there's youth group, there's a youth musical of Newsies Junior. For adults and people of all ages, we have Bible studies, book studies, small groups centered around fellowship, like the Discipleship Project that builds our faith, and others centered around pastoral care. We have music groups from choir, handbell choirs, even an orchestra that's intergenerational, various outreach ministries, and All of these programs not only need participants to exist, but also folks in the background to help them continue to thrive and to happen. And so if there are things that intrigue you, I encourage you to, again, check online, or as you exit the church today, talk to someone in the gathering space. It's going to be full of people that are interested to tell you about new ways you might connect in the life and ministries of Asbury First. And before or after that, if you're here, you can even walk down the hallway and check out our church library. If you've never been down there, it's wonderful. And today they even have a used book sale that you can check out as well. So with all of the ways set before us that we might connect in the life and ministries of Asbury First, I invite our ushers to come forward as we share our tithes and offerings that continue to make these ministries possible.
Let us pray together. Generous God, you have given us more than we can ever repay. Grace upon grace, love without end, and the gift of your Son, who breaks every barrier and heals every wound. As we offer these gifts to you, we do so with grateful hearts, dedicating them to the work of your realm. May our offerings be used to extend your love to all persons. Bless these gifts, O Lord, and use them to break down walls, open ears to hear your word, and embody the good news of Jesus Christ.
As you go into this day and into this week and into this world, go knowing that you are beloved. Go knowing that the world is beloved. Go and be love and grace and peace and mercy and justice to all you encounter this week. And may the peace of the Christ go with you as you do. Amen.
Open.